Radio, it is now time to head into the chat room, and joining me today is NBN presenter Gavin Morris in Newcastle, and Natalie Oliveri from Nine Honey is back for more.
Hello.
Welcome to both of you.
Hi.
Good afternoon, ladies.
First up, to the sentencing of Boris Rastevsky. With time already served, the convicted wife killer could spend less than 5 years in prison. And yet the day before, Joseph Esmaili was sent to jail for 10.5 years for punching a Melbourne heart surgeon. Esmaili, the first person to be sentenced under Victoria's one-punch laws, which mandate a minimum decade-long jail term. Two very different sentences in just 2 days, which has triggered furious debate over the need for law reform. The Victorian opposition calling for a parliamentary committee to consider mandatory minimum sentences for family violence. Gav, you can understand why people are so angry. It's not sending the right message, is it?
100% no, we're over it. Australians as a whole are over it. Victims of crime are over it, family members, but also the police force. We've got some of the best detectives in the world, and they have to work incredibly hard to gather the evidence according to the law so it can be presented into the courts. They do that, and it's almost a kick in to the teeth for them that have worked so very, very hard, along with family members and, of course, friends as well of victims. And this one has really revealed the discrepancy that has been ongoing in this country for so long. Why is this so often happening, that before the victims have left the court, or that the whole court hearing has left, the words appeal are being thrown around before they've even left the court? By the time they get to the front steps of the court, they've got themselves a brand new law firm. Then they're off to do the paperwork to present the appeal. The reason is that Australians have lost confidence in the overall decision-making process of some of the judges and magistrates and the sentences that are being handed down, because a lot of them just don't make sense. And this one has really revealed how diverse it is at the moment. So it definitely in need of reform.
Yeah, but I guess we also have to understand that the judges, they can, you know, only hand down sentences based on the law. So Nat, do you think that it is time that we look at mandatory sentences for family violence?
Absolutely. I mean, when I heard the result of this case, I thought 6 years for a woman's life, for a mother's life, is that all we are worth, 6 years? And it is very disgusting. It's actually very frightening as well. And it really just says to the community that, you know, if you do the crime, you're not going to do the time. I think there needs to be a mandatory sentence for family violence, for all violence. It scares me. In this particular case, the judge said that there was insufficient information to compare this manslaughter case to other cases of manslaughter, which is why he got such a reduced sentence. And I don't think that matters. I mean, if someone dies, someone dies. So why should how he killed her really matter in handing down the sentence?
Yeah, it's certainly something that needs to be looked at. But yet today, a survey out has ranked Australia as the safest country in the world for women for the second year running. Malta, Iceland, New Zealand and Canada also making the top five, as major European cities such as London and Paris slide down the list. Nat, so we must be doing a pretty good job here in Australia. Do you feel safe here in Australia? Do you think it's a safe place to live?
Overall, yes, I do, absolutely. But I mean,
do you think we deserve the top spot?
No, I mean, look at what we were just talking about. I mean, Karen Rastevsky's murder. And you have to think of all the other women who have just been walking home and they've been attacked by men unknown to them. Eurydice Dixon, Jill Maher. I grew up with the Anita Cobby case, so that always frightened me. I still have a phobia about walking from the station to my car. I have to park quite a few minutes away. Walking home in the dark, I have my keys in my hands or I'm on the phone to my fiance. It scares me, and I shouldn't have to be scared about that. I mean, that's just a basic thing, walking to and from the car to the station. And even when I'm at work, sometimes I have to park a little bit further away. It's just a basic thing that we shouldn't have to be frightened about.
Yeah, but definitely good for everyone to be vigilant and always aware. Gav, no surprise, though, that London and Paris slipped down?
Yeah, what a shame about Paris. I first visited Paris in the early 90s and went back there numerous times when I was based in New York for work, and just deteriorated over the years. It's an uncomfortable feeling in Paris now. There's an undertow of anger throughout that city and many other cities in Europe. So it's a real shame that you can travel to these tourist hotspots and not feel safe a lot of the time.
Yeah, unfortunately, that's what this terror does, isn't it? It strikes fear into us. I have to say, even when I'm visiting Melbourne now with my eldest daughter, I'm always alert.
And I think also the bollards that are put up everywhere now makes you feel unsafe. I mean, you automatically do think about the worst.
Mm, that's true. Let's head straight back into the chat room with Natalie Oliveri and Gavin Morris. Now, airports will be buzzing this Easter as people take off for the long weekend. Unfortunately, not us guys.
No.
Stuck here at work. But soon it may not just be our bags that need to be weighed in a bid to cut costs and carbon emissions. Passengers could soon be discreetly weighed with pressure pads at self-service baggage drops or at security body scan machines. The data used to determine exactly how much fuel is required for the flight. Gav, would you be okay with this?
Oh, this is a furphy, isn't it? First of all, let's talk about wing loading. When you load up a wing, it does two things to these planes. It makes the runway or the takeoff and landings just a little bit longer. So we've got the runways that can handle that. It changes the handling a little bit. But overall, it's not that much of a difference. And the averages, they're there. I mean, really, do they want us to believe that, you know, we're loading onto the plane and there's a guy fueling it up at the bowser and he's like, oh, mate, I've got a heavy guy in row 60, whack in a couple of extra litres so we make it. They have to carry extra fuel anyways because they may not be able to land at their destination due to weather.
Yeah. I know, this is a thing that worried me, but what sometimes they have to circle for hours. So what are they going to start doing? Just, oh, well, they'll just, like, you know, trim it down and then you would hope that wouldn't happen, would you, Nat?
Well, they do have 2 hours of extra fuel per flight, so I think we don't have to worry too much there. But as a passenger, if I know I'm going to be weighed before getting on the plane, that's just going to add extra worry. I mean, I think this is really targeting...
But if it's discreet,
no one knows, why does
it matter?
I think it's still targeting overweight people and...
So you
even
feel
when
like
they
would feel
Well, that's the thing. They're feeling like victims. They already will be going to the airport conscious about fitting into a small seat, conscious about putting a seatbelt around their waist and worrying whether they're going to need a seatbelt extender. So I think regardless of whether they know or not, it's still targeting them. And I'm someone who always gets picked out for the extra security scan. I always have to do the body scanning thing. And so I'm apprehensive about that. So having an extra worry about being weighed at the airport, I wouldn't like it. I think it's unfair. And they should come up with other ways of reducing the weight on the plane, maybe using different cutlery, perhaps, using different blankets,
different
maybe, because it all does add up.
What difference is that going to make?
It all adds up.
I guess it all adds up, I know. But, you know, I think it's good that they're thinking of ways to try and cut emissions.
Yeah, I can see the reason why. Maybe just make the bag restrictions a bit tighter. And
no,
that's going to annoy. I know, that's going to annoy people
don't
as well.
Do it. Okay, a fun one to finish on this Friday. And a pregnant woman has sought advice on an online forum after her family and friends slammed her favourite baby name as a dog's name. Her and her partner had settled on the name Huxley, but now she's not so sure. Nat, what do you think? Do you like the name Huxley? And is it okay to criticise a baby's name or should people just keep their opinion to themselves?
Well, I think firstly, if you don't want to know someone's opinion, don't tell them the baby name. Keep the baby name to yourself because regardless, you're going to hear someone criticise it. Not everyone's going to like the name you've chosen. I think people, if you're presented with a name and ask for your opinion, just be nice and say, oh, that's a nice name. I personally think Huxley, yes, it does sound a bit like a dog's name, but hey, there are some other normal names out there that I don't like, so it's a personal choice.
It is so personal. Gav, should this woman listen to everyone's opinion or just ignore them?
Oh, ignore them. Isn't that the greatest part about getting old? As we get older, we just don't give a hoot about what anybody else thinks or says. Obviously, they're a little bit young there. Huxley is cool. I like it.
Yeah,
it sounds like
Huxley.
The Hulk for short. Hux. Go the Hux. I don't mind it at all, but it's incredibly freeing once you get to the point in life where you just don't care about anybody else's opinion.
Well, my youngest daughter, her name's Coco, and when we told her sisters, one of them said, don't call her Coco. That's a cat's name. But we love Coco, and she couldn't be anything else. That's a beautiful name.
I find it would be...
leave it there, Nat. Sorry.
Okay, no,
happy Easter to both of you.
See you later.
Happy Easter.
Thanks for joining us.